It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. I didn't think this government could get more callous. But the next thing you know, the member from Mississauga-Streetsville called the police on Melanie Palapon, the mother of a 6-year-old boy with autism. Melanie just wanted to be heard, but instead her own MPP sent the police to her door. It's one thing to refuse and cancel meetings. It's another thing to block the parents of a child with autism on Twitter. But what I can't believe is they'd have the nerve to call the police on a constituent. And regardless of that apology, that action is completely unacceptable. Melanie simply wanted a few answers. Specifically, she wanted to ask, who are you to decide my child's future? Who are you to decide he is not worthy of a better life? So, Mr. Speaker, my question to the Premier is, who is this Premier to decide that this 6-year-old Xavier is not worthy of a better life?
You see it, please. Thank you, Premier.
You should.
Mr. Speaker, I'm tempted to say, and now for something completely different, but let me just begin by reminding the member that the member has apologized to Ms. Palapon. I know that he's profoundly sorry for the circumstances that resulted and the anxiety that was caused to her and her family. We know how important it is to listen to constituents on all matters, Mr. Speaker, and our caucus members have been meeting with families from across Ontario to explain how the new autism program will work, to make sure that they are getting the information that they need, Mr. Speaker, because that is of concern to us if families are not getting the information that they need in terms of transition, because, Mr. Speaker, at the root of the new autism program is the intent and the directive to make sure that every child in this province who has autism gets the service and the intensity of service that they need, Mr. Speaker.
Right. Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. This is not an issue to make jokes about. This is a heartbreaking real-life story of the callousness of this Liberal government. You know, I met with Melanie and her 6-year-old son, Xavier. She is an amazing mother with an equally amazing son. And I'm happy that the member finally, belatedly apologized, but it was only after this government got embarrassed on the front pages of the newspapers. It wasn't right. It got exposed, and that's why the apology finally happened. It's not just kicking off a child with autism from the waiting list that we're seeing this government undertake. It's cutting care at the province's children's hospitals. Last year, the Liberals cut 42 jobs at the children's hospitals.
Excuse me. The member from Beaches East York, I would like to do my job, please. The member from Beaches East York will withdraw.
Withdraw, Speaker.
That's not going to help. Please finish.
Mr. Speaker, this is a pattern. If it's an example, the 42 jobs at the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario. Right. Sick Kids in Toronto has been forced to operate at over 100% capacity. Mr. Speaker, how much longer will the Liberals turn their backs on the most vulnerable children in Ontario?
Question, thank you. Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, we are increasing funding to healthcare each and every year, Mr. Speaker. We are putting into a new autism program $330 million, Mr. Yeah. Speaker, in order to provide a better program. That's $333 million more than is already in the system, Mr. Speaker. The point of doing that is to make sure that we provide programming for kids who are right now sitting on a waiting list and not getting any service, Mr. Speaker. That status quo is unconscionable. We have to make sure that we provide the service that those kids need. Mr. Speaker, the investments that we have made in health care, the investments that we're making in autism, are about providing the services that children, seniors, families across this province need, Mr. Speaker. That's the intention of the investments that we're making, Mr. Speaker, and we're seeing results, which I'll speak to in the supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The Premier says investments in health care. Her investments mean cutting 42 staff at CHEO. Her investments mean kicking 2,200 kids off the list for desperately needed IBI. Her investments mean you have sick kids at over capacity. Her investments are the diminishment of health care in Ontario. Now, the Premier says that their investments in autism is the right course, is evidence-based, but let me point out what the Ottawa Citizen wrote. In January of 2014, a report from the Autism Spectrum Disorder Clinical Expert Committee stated that the therapy should not be cut for children over the age of 5. There is no evidence to back up your approach. There is no evidence to back up your cuts. So, Mr. Speaker, my question to the Premier is, where exactly is the evidence found to defend taking IBI from kids over 5?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker.
You see it, please? You see it? Thank you. Premier.
Therapy's not being cut to children over 5. The point is that there are children sitting on waiting lists. There are children sitting on waiting lists who are not getting any service at all, Mr. Speaker.
Finish, please, Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, the fact is that this program is about getting more service to more kids, Mr. Speaker. 16,000 more kids getting service. Kids who are getting
Member
service
from Hamilton
now,
Mountain.
making sure that they go through a transition. You know, I've met with the organizations of parents, Mr. Speaker, who are concerned about this. I've listened to them. The minister and I have talked about the reality that perhaps we need to look at direct funding as part of the model. That's something that parents have brought forward to us. Well, the member opposite heckles, perhaps. The fact is $8,000 of transition, that is direct funding, Mr. Speaker. And what we're looking at is there a better way, is there a better way to help those families make the transition?
Answer.
We're working hard on this side of the House, Mr. Speaker, to make sure the kids get service. The opposition can choose to negate that, Mr.
Thank
Speaker.
You.
The reality is more kids need.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Start the clock. New question. Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. It's clear that this government is cutting health care across the board. They slashed $815 million. From physicians for patient care, not to mention the 1,400 nurses cut in Ontario in the last year, clinics closing all across the province. But what most people don't see day to day is the ridiculous and the unacceptable overcrowding in Ontario's hospitals. When I first saw it in Brampton, I couldn't believe that hospital beds were littered in the hallway. That can't happen in Ontario. So what fantasy world is this government living in when they say they are investing in health care? Instead of getting beds out of the hallway, this government has the nerve to run self-congratulatory radio ads about what a great job they're doing in health care. So, Mr. Speaker, my question is, someone has to take responsibility. Will the Premier do the right thing and make sure her Minister of Health takes responsibility for the chaos that he has created?
Thank you. Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I know the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care is going to want to comment on the supplementaries, but Mr. Speaker, let me just talk about what's happening as a result of the investments that we are making in and have made in health care, Mr. Speaker, including the $1 billion more that was in this budget that the opposition voted against, Mr. Speaker. 94% of Ontarians have access to family health care providers. The Independent Wait Time Alliance has made a statement that we've gone from the worst to first for reducing wait times. That's in hip and knee replacements, cataract surgery, cardiac care, radiation oncology, MRIs, CT scans, and ultrasounds. The Fraser Institute, let me just pause there. The Fraser Institute who, you know, great friends of the member opposite, their 2015 Waiting Your Turn report revealed that Ontario has the second shortest overall wait times in Canada, Mr. Speaker. The results speak for themselves. The investments that we have made and are making a difference, Mr. Speaker. We will continue to make those investments and improve health care in Ontario.
Member from Dufferin-Caledon will come to order. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier, and I realize the government's talking points is everything is fine, but I would love to have the Premier name a single patient, a single nurse, a single physician in the province of Ontario that isn't fed up with this government's cuts. Now, let me share with you an article from the Toronto Sun. I think Christina Blizzard summed it up very eloquently when she said, I quote the Toronto Sun, this government is taking a hacksaw to health care in Ontario.
Come to order. Please.
And, Mr. Speaker, if the government members want to heckle about the article on their hacksaw approach to health care, why don't they listen to this quote from Ontario's Health Coalition, Natalie Mera. Natalie Mera said, there is no tracking of the health care cuts by the health ministry. There is no planning for the cuts and no attempt to get things right. She said there is no actual plan for our hospitals. Mr. Speaker, since it is now clear the Minister of Health isn't doing his job, isn't planning for health care in the province, Mr. Speaker, given the fact there's going
to
be a cabinet shuffle, will the Premier show the Minister of Health the door?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Health and long-term care.
Health and long-term care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, of course, I'm kind of happy that she just handed that, rather than answered herself, that she handed that question to me. The leader of the official opposition knows that, I'm sure he's seen the figures, that the vast majority of the hospitals across this province function and operate within less than 100% occupancy. In fact, the figures that are most that are currently reflected are the Q4 figures, which represent a period in time, those January, February, March months, where typically because of flu season and other factors, we do often see an incremental increase. But even with that, only 11% of the hospitals across the province indicated occupancy pressures. But when you look at the trend, Mr. Speaker, even compared to 2013, or rather in between 2014 and 2015, the number of hospital sites that have reported a point in time occupancy rate greater than 100% has decreased, Mr. Speaker, by 32% over that period of time.
Thank you.
Yep.
No supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The Liberals' failure to properly fund health care is leading to hospitals bursting at the seams. Across the province, hospitals are over capacity because of the government's cuts. Sick Kids, over capacity. London Health Services Centre, over capacity. Rouge Valley Health System in Ajax and Pickering, over capacity. The Juravansky Hospital and Cancer Care Centre in Hamilton, over capacity. The Peterborough Regional Health Centre, Brantford General Hospital, Ottawa Civic and General Hospitals, all over capacity. So, Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Health has this
Minister
crisis.
Of Agriculture.
This crisis is because.
Minister of Agriculture, come to order. Sorry. Please.
Mr. Speaker, this is a crisis created by the Minister of Health. This is because of the incompetent leadership on health care. So, Mr. Speaker, my question is this. Will the Premier answer directly? Will she do a favour to Ontario's patients and fire this Minister of Health?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Minister.
Speaker, and Mr. Speaker, in our budget, we've allocated an additional $345 million specifically to the hospital environment. But if you look back a couple of years since 2013, we've also dramatically increased the number of acute care beds in Ontario. It's increased by approximately 5% of the total number of beds to almost 20,000 beds now in the province, an increase of nearly 1,000 beds in that time period alone. But other important indicators as well. We have seen an increase because of population increase in the number of ER visits, Mr. Speaker. But we've wait times have either stayed the same or, in fact, they've improved, Mr. Speaker. So those important outcomes that patients are and should be looking to in terms of the quality of care that they're receiving, the readmission rates, which are staying the same or declining, and our ability to accommodate people in ERs, we are seeing and continuing to see progress in those areas, Mr. Speaker.
The question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Documents obtained by New Democrats show that somewhere in Ontario, there's an unnamed hospital that needs $287 million in repairs to address health and safety concerns, imminent breakdown, and code compliance. What hospital is that?
Deputy House Leader, second time. Premier.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we acknowledge that we have more than 150 hospitals across this province. We're building new hospitals like the new hospital in Oakville, the Humber River Hospital as well. They just had a groundbreaking ceremony, Mr. Speaker, in Orangeville for the new headwaters improvements that are being made. But we recognize that going forward in two areas, maintenance and renovations and repairs, where we've increased in the most recent budget an additional $50 million a year to go towards that. But we're also investing, Mr. Speaker, $12 billion over the next decade to make the kinds of improvements that Ontarians across this province expect to see in their hospitals. We have hospitals that are literally months old. We have hospitals that are decades old. We continue to invest in both areas to make sure that they're able to maintain themselves properly, and we're building, renovating, expanding, and rebuilding where necessary as well, Mr. Speaker.
Yeah. Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, next on the list of hospitals in dire need of repair is a hospital that needs $252 million in maintenance repair. Speaker, which hospital is that?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm proud of the work that we're doing across the province in making sure that Ontarians have access to the highest quality of care. And we do that as close to home as possible. So the Leader of the Third Party knows of, and certainly the opposition party as well, some of the efforts that we've been making over the last year, including places like the Trenton Hospital, to make sure that the services that those individuals rely on are provided, in Leamington Hospital, where there is a decision made, quite frankly, Mr. Speaker, by the hospital itself to close the obstetrics ward. We weren't prepared to accept that as a government, and we worked diligently, and I worked with the member for representing Chatham, Kent, Essex as well, to make sure that those birthing services, those obstetrical services were maintained. And in fact, I think he would probably agree with me that we've even been able to enhance the services that are provided there, and we've provided funding for three new obstetricians to work there in concert with midwives, providing that holistic support.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Next on the list is a hospital that urgently needs $171 million, Speaker, in maintenance. I would just ask the Premier, which hospital is that?
Well, Mr. Speaker, that's precisely why we committed to $12 billion over the next decade, and we have a process in place. I mean, the leader of the third party might just want to randomly select hospitals and invest in them. We have a very rigorous process through the ministry, together with Infrastructure Ontario, where we will look at both maintenance and repairs, but also those new builds that are required from time to time. What I don't understand, Mr. Speaker, if this is such an important issue to the third party, why they voted against our budget that allocated $50 million for new money on renovations and $12 billion over 10 years for new builds, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question.
Well, Speaker,
the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My next question is for the Premier. Last December, the Auditor General said there was $2.7 billion needed for hospitals in order to bring them up to a good state of repair. Now documents obtained by New Democrats show that a deferred maintenance in Ontario's hospital actually exceeds $3.2 billion, Speaker, but the government refused to tell us which hospitals are in the worst shape. In fact, the government said that if they revealed the names of the hospitals, contractors could lose confidence that they would get paid. Why is the Premier letting hospitals fall into disrepair, Speaker?
Well, Mr. Speaker, actually, as the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care has said, we recognize that there is a need for upgrades, for maintenance and repair, Mr. Speaker, which is why $12 billion over the next 10 years has been put in place to actually address those, Mr. Speaker. And, you know, there is a process in place whereby the condition of the facilities is made clear, Mr. Speaker. There's obviously an order in which those facilities have to be addressed, and that's what the $12 billion is for, Mr. Speaker. And I would have thought that the leader of the third party would think it was important to allocate that money because she understands that there is a need among hospitals.
Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, the Auditor General said that the funding wasn't keeping up. In fact, hospitals are having to dip into operating budgets just to cover their capital costs. And now we've learned that the backlog is even higher than what the Auditor General identified in her report. Ontario has 142 hospitals with over $3 billion in deferred maintenance. The government refuses to reveal which hospitals need the most repairs, and instead of planning ahead, the government has no idea how much more maintenance will be needed over the coming years. Health care is the government's silent crisis, Speaker. Failing to do urgent repairs will only make it worse. Will the Premier admit that there is, in fact, a silent crisis in health care here in the province of Ontario?
Thank you.
Long-term care?
Minister of Health, long-term care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, only the NDP can turn a positive in a negative. And I think the reason they're doing that is they're a little embarrassed that they didn't vote in favour of our budget. It allocated $1 billion new money to the health care budget. But in addition to that, Mr. Speaker, $12 billion over the next 10 years. And we have $50 million on top of an existing $50 million a year for those important maintenance and renovations and repairs. But, Mr. Speaker, it's not surprising that they're taking this position. It's easy when they're the third party to have this sort of rhetoric, but I just need to remind the Ontario public that when they were in power, Mr. Speaker, they closed 24% of all acute care beds in this province, and they closed 13% of all the mental health beds in this province, reducing hospital funding in their last budget,
and
reducing health care funding in the budget before that, Mr. Speaker. That sounds like a lot of cuts to me.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, nurses are being fired at a rate of 3 per day. Hospital beds are being closed. Wait times are increasing. And the Liberals are letting hospitals crumble here in the province of Ontario. When people go to the hospital, they're being treated in the hallways, Speaker. There are labels on the hallways saying hallway room 1, hallway room 2, hallway room 3. That's what people are dealing with when they go into a hospital here in Ontario in 2016, Speaker. How much worse does it have to get for the Premier to admit that there is a crisis in our health care system?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you, Minister.
Well, the only crisis, Mr. Speaker, would have come if that party had won the last election, because they committed to reducing the budget by $600
million,
Mr. Speaker, saying.
Minister.
Well, that's what the member from Kitchener-Waterloo said, that $600 million would come from health care and education. She actually said that she felt she would go to health care first. But, Mr. Speaker, the truth is, if you listen to the Ontario College of Nurses, the 3,000 more nurses in this province last year, about 8,000 of them in the last several years, many of those in the hospital environment. I just said that we've increased since 2013 the number of hospital beds in the province, the acute care beds, by more than 1,000. Hamilton. We have among, if not the shortest wait times in the entire country. The
member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek, come to order. Carry on, please.
Try as they might, Mr. Speaker, but they can't use rhetoric against facts. The facts demonstrate that we're continuing to invest, and we're seeing that progress, Mr. Speaker.
New question. The member from Nicholson.
Thank you, and good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. North Bay Regional Health Centre has borne the brunt of the impact of this government's waste, mismanagement, and scandal. Over $50 million has been cut over the last 3 years, resulting in cuts to nursing, emergency, cleaning, cataract surgery, psychiatric care, and forensic units. Specifically, the Liberal government has fired 350 full-time staff, including 100 nurses. They've cut 60 hospital beds at our five-year-old facility, a facility the community fundraised for. And now rumors are swirling that the hospital's cancer clinic will be closed by the end of the year. Speaker, can the Premier tell the people of Nipissing that our cancer clinic will not close?
Thank you.
For health and long-term care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I mean, rumor mongering like this is not helpful, and I'm sure it's creating anxiety in the community. So we have no plans to change the level and the quality and the location of cancer services at North Bay, at the new North Bay Regional Health Centre, by the way, Mr. Speaker. And the funding that has increased since we came in power to that health centre by 126%, or almost $100 million, we're seeing great results. I wish the member opposite would commend the hospital and the physicians for where we're seeing cataract surgery go down by 370 days, a decrease in the wait time of 87%, Mr. Speaker. This is a victory. I'm so proud of this hospital. I'm so proud of the management. Hardworking healthcare professionals. The member opposite should champion their hard work.
Yeah.
Well, I'll share your message with the 100 nurses you fired. Back to the Premier. These are headlines announcing the Liberal.
Come to order. Question, please.
These are the headlines announcing the Liberal government cuts all throughout the North. Health Sciences North lays off 102 employees and closes 64 beds. 28 beds close in Lakehead Psychiatric Hospital. St. Joseph's Care Group cuts 11 RPN jobs. Timmins and District Hospital cuts 38, followed by another heading. Timmins Hospital cuts 40 jobs. Temiskaming Hospital cuts 15 jobs, including 9 nurses. Sioux Area Hospital cuts 73 staff, followed by another heading, Sioux funding cut by $10 million, 35 positions cut. Speaker, this government's waste, mismanagement, and scandal have hurt northern families. Will the Premier tell us today, does she support these cuts at health care, or will she shuffle out the Minister of Health?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Start the clock. The member from Nipissing will come to order. Minister of Health.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I can only imagine what would have happened, Mr. Speaker, if that party had been given the opportunity to cut 100,000 jobs in the broader public sector, and many of those.
Member from Nipissing, second time. Minister of Labour, come to order. Minister, finish, please.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So in hospitals alone in Northern Ontario. So we recognize the need to improve and modernize infrastructure. That's why 23 new hospitals have been built or are underway in the north, Mr. Speaker. And, and Thunder Bay Regional Hospital, Health Sciences North and Sudbury, North Bay Regional Health Centre, Sioux Lookout Health Centre, Sioux Area Hospital, West Parry Sound Health Centre, Mattawa General Hospital. We've increased hospital funding in the north by 54%, Mr. Speaker. We have seven community capital projects underway and $157 million for surgeries, Mr. Speaker.
Yeah. New question. The member from Kenora Rainy River.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Today, groups supporting Grassy Narrows First Nation released an independent study commissioned by the First Nation that recommends that the cleaning up of the Wabagoon English River system of the mercury that was dumped there 50 years ago is possible. Will the Premier commit today to an action plan to clean up the Wabagoon River so that future generations don't have to grow up poisoned and that the community of Grassy Narrows can heal?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I appreciate the question. I have not yet seen this report. I'm very interested to see the science on which it's based, Mr. Speaker. I have been to Grassy Narrows. We've established an Ontario Grassy Narrows working group to lead a discussion about what the solutions are, Mr. Speaker. My understanding is that there has been testing that has been ongoing, that the group will have a broad scope of inquiry, but that there are complicated issues around the settling of the mercury, Mr. Speaker, in the water at Grassy Narrows. I don't know the, as I say, I don't know the source of the report where I understand there's some suggestion that there is still new mercury that is leaking. I don't know the source of that. I look forward to looking at the report, Mr. Speaker, but rest assured that we are very much engaged, even before this report came, on trying to figure out how to make sure that people in Grassy Narrows have clean water and a clean environment.
Thank you.
Speaker, members of Grassy Narrows First Nation will travel this week, as they do every year, the 1,700 kilometres to Queen's Park to once again call on this government to do something, to act on the contamination of their traditional fishing and hunting lands. During this time last year, the Premier said, quote, "Scientists have said to us there are questions about how to actually do the cleanup because the sediment at the bottom can actually cause further damage," end quote. Yes, Speaker, this needs to be done very carefully, but here today, a report written by scientists says that it is possible to clean up the river. In the press today, the response from the Ministry of the Environment to this new report is word for word the same as the ministry comment from February. How is this possible? Truth and reconciliation, Speaker. It means being honest with our relationships with our First Nations partners. Will the Premier commit today to the cleanup of the Wabagoon River of the mercury once and for all?
This is an extremely important issue. It's an extremely important issue, obviously, because of the health of the people who live at Grassy Narrows. It's extremely important in terms of the economy of Grassy Narrows, and I know the member opposite is aware of that. I haven't seen this particular report, but, Mr. Speaker, as I said, the working group that has been established will have to take this information into account. And if there is a way, Mr. Speaker, to clean up that river without disturbing the mercury and making the situation worse, then obviously we want to look at that. And when I was at Grassy Narrows, that was one of the first questions I asked was, is there a way of cleaning up this mercury so that it doesn't actually further contaminate the water, the fish, and the other wildlife? So, Mr. Speaker, obviously we will look at the information, the ministry will look at the information, but the working group that is tasked with this specific subject is going to take this into account, Mr. Speaker, and look for a way forward.
Yep. Question, member from Scarborough Agincourt.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade. Ontario's newcomer settlement program support agency like the Center for Immigrants and Community Services, better known CICS, in my riding of Scarborough Agincourt. And this agency has provided almost 50 years of comprehensive, diverse program for newcomers of all ages, Mr. Speaker. And this settlement program supports communities to integrate in our province Since 2003, our government has invested over $82 million in newcomer settlement program. Wow. Each year, nearly 80,000 immigrants benefit from our investment. Speaker, through you to the minister, can he please inform the House what the newcomer settlement program is doing to support new Canadians?
Thank you, Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade.
Thank you, Speaker. I want to thank the member from Agent for asking the question. Speaker, over the next 2 years, 2016 to 18, our newcomer settlement program will provide $20 million in funding to support 114 projects across Ontario. Speaker, the funding will improve access to services by providing support to 97 settlement agencies, of which 19 are new. Speaker, it will double the number of Francophone service providers to attract and integrate Francophone newcomers. It also provides a threefold increase in settlement funding to expand services in Northern Ontario and improve service access for vulnerable immigrant populations such as refugees. Mr. Speaker, this is just the beginning. We will continue to support refugees as they integrate with Ontario community. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for the response. It is reassuring to see that our governments understand the importance of supporting agencies like CICS and the Chinese Professional Association of Canada to help newcomers settle in our communities. I'm also very pleased, Mr. Speaker, to see that the NSP funded services are available in a broad range of newcomers groups, such as permanent residents, Canadian citizens, refugees and refugee claimants, provincial nominees, temporary foreign workers, including the live-in caregivers and international students, because many of my constituents in Scarborough Asian Court have benefited from these programs. Organizations funded through the NSP have a proven track record of providing quality services to newcomers, possess organization capacity to deliver quality services, demonstrate sustainability and appropriate financial management. Speaker, through you to the minister, can he please outline the orientation to Ontario Immigrant Services and what it offers to new Canadians? Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, the NSP has been a great success. The Orientation to Ontario program is a service that helps current recent immigrants get quality information about settling in Ontario. The program is coordinated by COSTI Immigrant Services and is delivered in local communities by a network of 19 settlement agencies. An estimated 2,500 recent newcomers in 24 Ontario communities will benefit from the program 2015 to 16. Speaker, the program features a workshop series on settlement-related topics, a workbook for participants that includes settlement information and planning tools. There's also a website that is a great source for pre-arrival and settlement information. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Elgin, Middlesex, London.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Speaker, this government's record on health care has been disastrous. The Minister of Health has placed the system into a state of perpetual crisis. Last year alone in London, Windsor, and the rest of southwestern Ontario, we've seen a cut to health care services and longer wait times. Due to this minister's freezing of hospital budgets, we've seen hospitals forced to cut staff or cut services in order to balance the budgets. St. Joseph's Hospitals in London has had a $17 million budget shortfall, which saw 60 nurses fired. Wow. Windsor cut 120 nursing jobs with a $20 million budget shortfall. All knee, hip, and joint replacement surgeries were cancelled or postponed for January, February, and March because of a lack of funds. The Premier has not answered the questions from the member from Nipissing or the members from Simcoe North. Does she have confidence in this minister, and will she replace him?
Well, Mr. Speaker, thanks. I appreciate the question. It gives me an opportunity, because it has been some time since I've been able to speak about the new investments in the 2016-2017 budget, $1 billion, so that our entire health care budget is roughly $52 billion. It's substantial, to say the least. But as part of that $1 billion, we're investing in a whole set of things. I've spoken, obviously, on the $345 million going to hospitals and the $12 billion going to the new capital investments. But I haven't had an opportunity to say things like, $85 million of new dollars for that important area of recruitment and retention of nurses, of occupational therapists, of dietitians, many of them who are in the front line, who are working in our family health teams or other similar environments.
Answer.
Or importantly, the work of my parliamentary assistant, the member from Ottawa Centre, I hope. An investment of $75 million to
Thank
fund
you.
New hospice beds across the province,
Thank
Mr.
You.
Speaker.
Thank you. Supplemented.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Speaker, the only people that have confidence in this minister is the Premier herself. Just talk to the healthcare professionals across the province. They are disgusted with the access that they have had lack of due to this government. The public attacks this government has had on not only doctors but also pharmacists in this province. The Premier seems fine with this action. Mr. Speaker, we have seen the stem cell transplant system fail, resulting in deaths in this province, and the Premier is fine with this. We've seen this minister nurture a culture of fear in the home care system, and the Premier is fine with this. But the line was drawn 3 months ago when Pete Verbeen, a 61-year-old Alzheimer's patient, was forced to sleep on the floor in restraints for 8 days because the hospital was understaffed and over capacity. Even the member from London North Centre says this was absolutely unnecessary. Speaker, the healthcare system has been in perpetual crisis for years. There have been cuts in services, cuts in nurses, and our hospitals are over capacity.
Sorry, Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, it's a big question, and I'll do my best to answer to the satisfaction of the member opposite. But, Mr. Speaker, we are investing so much money in new investments that are relevant to Ontarians. And I think Ontarians, at the end of the day, what they look to are the outcomes. Are they able to access a family doctor or a nurse practitioner? 94% of them are. In fact, just the year before last, the most recent figures show 900 more new physicians began practice in this province. That's roughly almost four times the rate of population growth. So we're making investments in our doctors. We're continuing to increase the line of for compensation for doctors. 3,000 more nurses practicing in our province last year alone, according to the Ontario College of Nurses. We're continuing to make those important investments in people, in property, and the facilities that people depend on across this province, Mr. Speaker.
Yep. Thank you. New question, the member from Nickelback.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier.
Neville Howard, the very eloquent executive director of the Native Women Centre, tell us what we already knew, that 90 First Nations communities in Ontario do not have safe drinking water. In Attawapiskat, it contributed to a rash of skin lesions for young children. Here in Ontario, in 2016, First Nation children are sick because of untreated water. Does the Premier think that it is acceptable that after 13 years of Liberal government, Ontarians, First Nation Ontarians in 90 communities still do not have safe drinking water?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I do not think that it is acceptable that any Ontarian anywhere in the province would not have access to clean, drinkable water, Mr. Speaker. It is unacceptable to me, absolutely. And at the root of the ceremony that happened this morning and all of the work that we have done as a government, Mr. Speaker, to work with First Nations and, quite frankly, with the previous federal government to engage them, to try to get them to work with us, we moved ahead, Mr. Speaker. We have put in place a plan to address drinking water, and I think now we have a federal government that will work with us on that, Mr. Speaker. But it is absolutely our objective to address the challenges of drinking water on reserve, Mr. Speaker, to take all of the expertise that we have in Ontario, the technology that we have, and work with the federal government and the First Nations to put in place the right water supply for each of the First Nations in the province,
Thank
Mr.
you.
Speaker.
Parliamentary.
Thank you, Speaker. We all know that water is a basic human right. The rest of us in Ontario, we take it for granted. But when I ask during estimates for Ministry of Aboriginal Affairs, I'm told that it is a federal responsibility. But you know what, Speaker? Infrastructure needs in First Nation is an Ontario responsibility. We don't need to pass the buck on that one. I would like the Premier to tell this House When will First Nation Ontarians living in 90 First Nation communities, communities like Curve Lake, like Pecangicum, like Charlotte Lake 40, like Kitchenimikusiginiinuzig, will have safe drinking water?
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker, it's just the member opposite.
You see it, please. You see it, please. Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite might know that each situation is somewhat different. So, for example, on Pecangicum, it's my understanding, when I was there, there is clean water, but the water doesn't flow to people's houses. So, Mr. Speaker, in that case, there's an issue of building the infrastructure and making sure that that clean water can actually get to the houses. Mr. Speaker, in other situations, there are water treatment plants. It's not acceptable. It's not acceptable. But the situation is different community by community. That means we have to work with the communities and with the federal government, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that if it's the transportation of water or whether it's the water system itself, whether it's the training of the folks on the ground to make sure that the troubleshooting can happen, all of that has to be done, and it must be done in partnership with the First Nation
Answer.
And with the federal government. That's the work that we're doing in our government, Mr. Speaker.
New question, the member from Newmarket Aurora.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Community and Social Services. Last week, I was pleased to be with the Minister in Aurora for a funding announcement of almost $1 million over 2 years for a project that will offer a number of housing alternatives for people with a range of complex developmental disability needs in my riding of Newmarket Aurora. The Why Wait demonstration project is a collaboration between York Region Lifetime Independent Facilitation, York Support Services, and Montage Support Services. Minister, I understand this project is part of the broader Developmental Services Housing Task Force initiative that you mentioned in the House this year. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please provide us with an update on the recent work of the Housing Task Force and the progress being made for residential
Question.
Services in Ontario?
Minister of Community and Social Services.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and to the member for Newmarket Aurora for the question and for hosting me last week to announce the funding for the Why Wait demonstration project. As the member knows, these projects are part of a recent announcement of the second round of 6 creative community-based housing initiatives for adults with developmental disabilities. Our government has committed up to $6 million over 2 years for demonstration or research projects, which includes $2.13 million to support these 6 projects in Ottawa, Essex, Sarnia-Lambton, and Newmarket Aurora. This is part of our 3-year, $810 million investment to support the transformation and modernization of developmental services. The Developmental Services Housing Task Force has been doing extensive work in the area of creative residential services because we know
Answer.
That there is no one-size-fits-all housing solution for adults with developmental disabilities.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Minister, for outlining the work this government and your ministry is doing. In conversation with residents and leaders in my community, it's very clear the importance that adequate access to residential services has on the lives of individuals living with disabilities and their families. There continues to be a need for more creative residential options and day support and respite services. This is something that individuals, their families, and the developmental services sector has known for a long time. However, the government's $810 million investment is Wow. making a tremendous difference in the lives of thousands of Ontarians. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please elaborate how efforts like the Developmental Services Housing Task Force will create more opportunities that focus on inclusion, choice, and independence?
Good. Good. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we know that individuals with developmental disabilities have unique needs and that there is a demand for a broader range of housing solutions. This is why the 6 projects selected cover a wide range of supports, including developing a DSW co-op so that families have a pool of trained and qualified staff to hire using their passport funding, using technology to increase independence and quality of life, and digital tools to support Francophone families in their search for housing. I'd like to thank the hard work of agencies, families, community partners, and the Housing Task Force members. We have an opportunity to expand our knowledge and learn how creative partnerships can help us provide new housing support options. I look forward to future partnerships that we can learn from so that they can be replicated to help more people in the future. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you.
New question. The member from Halliburton, Port.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Day after day, I hear from constituents in my riding and across this province about the harsh reality of this government's incompetence. Whether it's freezing budgets at mid-sized hospitals like Ross Memorial, Peterborough Regional Health Centre being forced to eliminate 153 nursing positions, 61 RNs cut from St. Joseph's in Hamilton, or 70 nurses cut at the Trillium Health Centre in Mississauga. No area of this province has been spared from the government's failure to deliver on the home care, long-term care and mental health care that our patients need. The minister has failed his mandate to ensure that the needs of Ontario's patients be at the centre of our health system. While the Premier pledged to be different than her predecessor, we see that she is running down a path away from our patients, ruthlessly firing 1,400 nurses in the last year. Mr. Speaker, will the Premier finally support the growing needs of Ontario's patients?
Thank you.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, you know, try as I might, Mr. Speaker, I have to go back to this allegation from both opposition parties that somehow we fired 1,400 nurses over the last year. And again, so are you telling me you don't believe the Ontario College of Nurses, that is the body responsible for regulating nurses, which on their website they've indicated that 3,000 more nurses, the majority of those in hospitals, are working in this province, Mr. Speaker. And so I'm a little dismayed. I'm a little perplexed of why they just dislike and don't trust and don't believe the Ontario College of Nurses, because I think that that's probably the best and most independent source of information that we have, Mr. Speaker.
Yeah.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The government is out of touch.
Order.
Those numbers are true. I didn't make them up. I didn't pull them out of thin air. But you're no longer driven.
Come to order. Please finish with the question.
Thank you. As a nurse, I firmly believe that our registered nurses, our nurse practitioners, our registered practical nurses and nurses students deserve our support here and respect. If there are fewer nurses, then there are fewer nursing hours. That means that the number of hours of care for the patient are cut. After 13 years, this government has become both financially and morally bankrupt, and the accessibility and the quality of patient care have deteriorated, and they continue to crumble. So,
question.
Premier, since you haven't answered the member for Simcoe North, the member from Nipissing, or the member from Elgin, Middlesex, London, are you going to remove the Minister of Health?
Order. Minister of Health, long-term care.
So, you know, I would imagine that the member opposite, therefore, is a member of the College of Nurses of Ontario. So call them up, tell them that you're a paid member, ask them how many more nurses are working in our hospitals, are working in our communities last year alone, and it's 3,000 net. Not any gross number that the member opposite might want to talk about, a net increase, Mr. Speaker. But that's understandable because maybe her relationship isn't that great, because it was her government that fired 6,000 nurses when they were in power. It was her government that described them as out of time, out of sorts hula hoops, Mr. Speaker. And it was her government that closed 10,000 hospital beds. You talk about devastation in the hospital.
Answer.
We're rebuilding the mess that they created, Mr. Speaker.
New question. Member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. The government has introduced its election reform bill. It shuts down critics, helps the Liberal Party, makes it nearly impossible for nonpartisan citizens groups to get their message out. Instead, it opens the doors to partisan government advertising dominating the airwaves.
Yep.
It cracks down on public advocates but leaves the door open to lobbyists. This legislation clearly is about helping the Liberal Party. Can the Premier explain why they refuse to move ahead with a transparent, nonpartisan panel.
Well, thank you very much, Speaker. And again, I remain baffled by the question from the NDP, because every single opportunity when it was given to them to participate in a conversation around what the bill should contain, they said no. In fact, they refused to engage in any conversation,
stalling.
Speaker, because they probably wanted to delay the process because they have so much house cleaning to do on their end that they won't engage in the process that they were good. The official opposition engaged in the process. The Green Party of Ontario were quite engaged in the process, but the NDP, Speaker, no. No substantive ideas, but stall and delay tactics. Speaker, we have put forward a very robust plan to consult the public. As you know, Speaker, the bill has been tabled, has been referred to the Standing Committee for consideration over the summer months. We will be debating the motion dealing with that, which I sought a unanimous consent, which was denied by the NDP. We look forward to working and listening to Ontario's Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, we fully understand that the Liberals remain baffled on a number of issues, but this process is about restoring confidence in the electoral system. And the truth of the matter is that the Liberals wrote this legislation behind closed doors. They didn't consult a single expert. They didn't consult Ontarians. They didn't listen to the concerns raised by the opposition. This is about helping the Liberal Party and shutting down any public criticism. Now they're taking control of the committee process. Will the Premier put partisanship aside and open this process up to a non-partisan panel chaired by an independent person and not under the complete legislative control and total veto of the Liberal Party of Ontario?
Yes, Speaker, we remain baffled by NDP's flip and flops every single day. It baffled every single one of us because they keep flipping and flopping on all the positions. But Speaker, when we send them a letter inviting them to a meeting on the draft legislation, they said no. When we reached out to them on May 2nd asking them to attend the meeting on the draft legislation, they said no, Speaker. Then, Speaker, I sent them documents from my briefings with the official opposition and the Green Party and asked for the input. They said no, Speaker. But apparently they have some sort of suggestion out on a Facebook page. We're still addressed to the Premier, which she still hasn't received the letter, Speaker. This is how NDP has been stalling the whole democratic process around ensuring that Ontarians get a say on the draft legislation as soon as possible. Speaker, this afternoon we will be drafting the motion so that as of June 6th. Thank you.
New question, the member from Barrie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. As part of the Climate Change Action Plan, cap-and-trade proceeds will be invested transparently into initiatives that will help to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. These investments will create good jobs in sectors like clean tech and construction, help small and medium businesses reduce greenhouse gas pollution and help households save money on energy costs. Last week, the government shared the first set of these planned investments that will utilize these proceeds to drive our goal to fight climate change. Mr. Speaker, building on the success of the Green Investment Fund's dedication of $92 million for energy retrofits to social housing across this province, Minister McMeekin and Minister Murray announced a further plan to increase the energy efficiency of not only social housing but also private rental apartments. Mr. Speaker, through you, will the minister share with the House the details of this investment and speak how it will reduce costs?
Sorry. Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
That's a terrific question. What can I say? That's a good question. I got a good answer.
Of course you do.
Of course, reducing emissions, as everybody in this House knows, is a key priority for our government. And that starts with social housing and select units in the private housing sector. That's why, as part of our Climate Action Plan, We intend to provide up to $400 million for apartment building retrofits. That's, yeah, and $500 million for social housing retrofits. That's going to help with installing energy-efficient boilers, windows, insulation, lighting, and to be quite frank, Mr. Speaker, investing cap and trade proceeds in this way is really going to help not only provide additional access to affordable housing, but do it in a clean and environmentally sensitive way.
Supplementary.
Thank you to the minister for that answer. When we can invest in both combating climate change and helping low-income Ontarians with a transition to a lower-carbon economy, I think that's a huge win-win. Mr. Speaker, this announcement is part of the soon-to-be-released Climate Change Action Plan. The CCAP will outline the actions we are taking to ensure Ontario reaches its greenhouse gas emission target, and will focus on making it easier and faster for consumers and industry to access new low-carbon technology. The minister has committed that the action plan will be out before the House rises. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please inform the House on the action plan and the real positive benefits it will have on people's lives and in the fight against climate change?
Question. Thank you. Minister.
Speaker, to the Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Minister of Environment and Climate
Change. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I want to thank the member for Barrie, who's been such a great champion. And it's interesting, we visited homes in her constituency that are net zero or low carbon homes that the sale advantages, they come without a heating or cooling bill, Mr. Speaker. And Minister McMeekin and I think it was a humbling experience when we were at Green Phoenix housing, Mr. Speaker, because they've retrofitted that. And why did they do it? Because their heating costs were becoming expensive for their low-income tenants. So by reducing their emissions by 40%, they dramatically cut the costs of living in the home. And what they discovered was a low greenhouse gas emissions home was a very inexpensive affordable housing building to do. So there's lots to be learned from people out in the community, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
New question, the member from Whitby-Oshawa.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Premier, in February I asked the Minister of Health why the government cut jobs on Ontario's shores. The Minister's response, Mr. Speaker, in an answer that sounded as though it was drafted in an ivory tower. Despite the Minister's protest to the contrary, when you cut frontline services at hospitals, wait times get longer. That's just a fact, Mr. Speaker. My constituents in Whitby-Oshawa sent a strong message to the government that they're tired of this government's failed policies, which lead to longer wait times and watered-down services, that they're tired of waste and mismanagement. Mr. Speaker, the Premier still hasn't answered. Will she shuffle out the Minister of Health?
Thank you.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, in our most recent budget, we announced an allocation, an increase in the budget to Ontario Shores of over $2 million, Mr. Speaker, and it comes on the heels of some other important investments, inpatient addictions investment that we recently made, the extremely important eating disorder inpatient program that now exists at Ontario Shores. It's an important, I know, quite frankly, that institution, that hospital environment that provides such important high quality of care, it's important not just to the residents of that region but to the entire province,
exactly.
Mr. Speaker. So it's Ontario Shores is one of the hospitals that we're focusing a tremendous amount of attention on to make sure that it is on an up-to-date basis providing that high quality of care that Ontarians can and should expect, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The member from Leeds, Grenville, on a point of order.
Yes, point of order, Speaker. I'd like to introduce to you and through you to members of the Legislative Assembly, constituents of my riding of Leeds-Grenville. I have a delegation of my second girls' government. They're from three high schools in Brockville, and also representatives from Girls Inc. of Upper Canada. Welcome to Queen's Park.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like you to invite them every day.
The member from Nickelbelt on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to correct my record. This morning I said that children in Attawapiskat were suffering skin lesion. That was a mistake. It's Keseshawan I meant to say.
The member has every right to correct her own record. The member from Kitchener Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I invite you and my colleagues here in the House to join me in wishing a very happy birthday to the member for Burlington. And I'm told that this is the 25th anniversary of her 29th birthday. So happy birthday.
Thank you. The member from Thornhill.
Mr. Speaker, I just want to welcome today Marlene Galliott and Jeff Peller. Welcome to the members' gallery.
Thank you. London West.
Thank you, Speaker. I am sure that all members of this House will want to join me in expressing our pride and congratulations to the London Knights, who won the Memorial Cup on the weekend.
Member from Etobicoke Lakeshore on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to welcome to the House a constituent from Etobicoke Lakeshore, Mai Nguyen. Welcome to Queen's Park.
Thank you. The member from Prince Edward Hastings.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I'd like to welcome two guests of mine from Belleville. I'm sure they were there in 99 when the Bulls won the OHL championship. Jean-Vive Pouliot and Stanley Jones are here. Welcome.
Thank you. Welcome. The member from Northumberland, Quinty West.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to welcome, I know they're somewhere in the building, but they were here before, former member Rob Milligan, now teacher, came for high school in his class.
Thank you. Member from Beaches, East York.
Yes, thank you, Speaker. And during constituency week, I'm pleased to say the member from Trinity Spadina had his birthday. Happy
thank
birthday,
you.
Member Trinity Spadina.
The member from Scarborough North. No, sorry. The member from Etobicoke North.
Thank you, Speaker. I would take this opportunity to respectfully invite all colleagues to a reception today from 5 to 7 p.m. hosted by His Excellency Erdenis Sen, the Consul General of Turkey to Ontario. Thank you, Speaker.
The member from the Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just want to remind members that there's an African Union flag raising here at the Legislature today at 12 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you. I showed a little bit of lenience just in this particular situation due to the fact that we did not have introductions because of our ceremony this morning. But I'm going to remind members that we do have an agreement that we use the 5 minutes for introductions at that time. And I would help. I would hope that you would help me in sticking to that. I'm lenient in the 5 minutes. If there's a large number after that, it's off bounds. So anyway, there are no deferred votes. This House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon. Thank you.